Class, we were discussing from chapter 26 about the manifestation of 24 material elements and their various properties. And the previous class we discussed about the properties of the other four elements such as Mahatattva and also Chetana. Sorry, not Mahatattva. The Pradhana, which is also called Prakriti, Avyakta and Anitya, Dravya, etc. And Kala, Lord's energy, another aspect of Maya Devi. So that Kala also we discussed, different properties of Kala we discussed. And then Jiva and Ishvara. Ishvara, Jiva, Prakriti, Kala, and then 24 elements. Thus, there are total 28 elements, studying about which the subject matter is called as Sankhya. So then, one by one, we discussed about the properties of all these 24 elements. One after the other, starting with Mahatattva, then Chitta, then Ahankara, and then the mind, intelligence, senses. So there is not much mention about the senses, sensory activities and all, but in one verse it was just summarized. And then the five grass elements along with their properties, the five Tanmatras, that discussion went on elaborately. One more verse talks about the properties of all these all these properties of all these elements. So in that way. So now, after mentioning all these things, at the end he says that when it comes to ether, ether has got one property, that is sound. And then there is air, the next element is air. Air has two properties, sound and touch. And then fire has three properties, sound, touch and form. And then there is water has four properties, sound, touch, form and taste. Finally, the earth has five properties, which includes fragrance also. So that is where we stopped, and today we'll continue what happens afterwards. Parasya drishyate dharmo e aparasmin samanvayat ato visesho bhavanam Bhumau evo palakshate. Verse number 49. Someone can read the translation.
Since the cause exists in its effect as well, the characteristics of the former are observed in the latter. That is why the peculiarities of all the elements exist in the earth alone.
Yeah. So earth alone will have all the five properties. Water has four, fire has three, air has two, ether has one. So in that sense, in earth, we can find everything. So that is understanding. So the unique quality of each elements are mentioned in the previous two verses. The previous quality is the cause of the successing element. Because as we studied that, first sound manifested, then the via medium for the sound, the transportation via medium for the sound, there appeared ether. Then from ether, there appeared touch. Then the via medium for touch to transmit from one place to other place, the wind or air manifested. Then from air, there appeared form. For the form to go from one place to other place, the agni appeared. And then from agni, water appeared. Sorry, taste appeared. For the taste to go from one place to other place, there appeared water. And from water, fragrance came. For the fragrance to move from one place to other place, there appeared earth. It is earth which transmits the fragrance from one place to other place. So that is how it is understood. So earth itself will have all the five properties. So that is indicated. Having described the appearance of causes of creation, having described the appearance of 24 material elements, now Lord Kapila describes the appearance of the effect. these 24 elements are the cause of the universe. The effect is the universe itself. How? By combining these 24 elements, the universe has formed and came into existence and became functional. That is the rest of the chapter. एतानि असम्यतायदा महत् आदेनि सप्तवै कालकर्मागुणेपेतो जगत् आदेर् उपाविशत्.
When all these elements mix, the supreme personality of Godhead, the origin of creation, along with time, work, and the qualities of the modes of material nature, entered into the universe with the total material energy in 7 divisions.
Yeah. Etani asamyatayada mahat adini saptavai. Though there are 24 elements, 7 is mentioned here just to indicate the important elements. Since these 7 are important, so it is indicated like that. So etani asamyata yada, because all the 24 elements were not combined together and they were situated apart, separate from each other, mahat adini saptavai. Kala karma gunopeto jagat adir upavishas. In order to combine them, in order to manifest the universe, the Supreme Lord entered into all the 24 elements along with Kala, Karma and Guna. When the 7 elements starting with Mahatattva did not combine, the Supreme Lord entered all the elements along with time, karma and prakriti. So that is indicated here. So when all the elements were separate, the Lord then combines them with his cohesive energy. When the elements remained in unmixed state, the Supreme Lord entered them. First, in order to combine all the elements by his compacting energy, he entered into the elements. This means that he entered into those elements along with time, which is agitating factor, karma, which is the fate of all the living entities, and prakriti, or swabhava of the jivas, the innate nature of all the jivas, kala, karma and swabhava. With these 3 elements, the Supreme Lord entered into those 24 elements in order to combine them. Previously, the Supreme Lord, through his glance, impregnated prakriti with these 3 elements, with these 3 things, kala, karma and swabhava. So thus, he entered into all of them. Then what happened? So the same thing is also mentioned in the 2nd canto and 3rd canto, in the 5th chapter and 6th chapters. So where the process of creation has been detailedly explained, where it is mentioned in the 2nd canto, yadaite asangata bhava bhutendriya manoguna yada yatana nirmanena shekur brahma vittama tada samhata chanunyam bhagavat shakti chodita sad asatvam upadaya chobayam sasruju hi yada. O best of the brahmanas, as long as the grass elements, the panchamahabhutas, senses, the 5 jnanendriyas, 5 karmendriyas, and mind, which also includes mind, intelligence, ego and chetana, were not mixed together, it was not possible for them to produce material bodies. Coming together by the impulse of the Lord's energy, the cohesive energy, Bhagavat Chakti Chodita, accepting primary and secondary forms, they created the body of the whole universe and the individual bodies in it. So with the help of this cohesive energy, by combining 24 elements, Lord Vishnu manifested all the universes and Lord Brahma manifested different bodily structures for all the variety of living entities, such as plants, animals, humans and superhumans. So that is the understanding. That Vibhu Shakti, known as cohesive energy, is the combining energy of all these 24 elements in order to manifest the universes as well as the individual bodies. So as the Lord's cohesive energy consisting of Kala, Karma and Swabhava enters into these 24 elements, then what happened? Tatascano viddebhyo yuktebhyo andamachetanam uttitam purusho yasmat udatishtad anu asau virat. Someone can read.
From these seven princes aroused into activity and united by the presence of the Lord, an unintelligent egg arose, from which appeared the celebrated cosmic being.
So here the understanding is, by the Lord's entrance into the elements as cohesive energy, the Supreme Lord did not enter into elements there personally, but he has just entered in the form of cohesive energy. They combined together, all the 24 elements combined together and formed an unconscious globe. Andam achetanam utitam. By the combination of all these 24 elements, there appeared unlimited brahmandas, which are also called as hiranyandas, because the outward layer is mahatattva layer, and mahatattva is like a fiery or golden effulgence. That's why they are all called as hiranyandas or brahmandas. So this is nothing but a universal shell with emptiness inside. The shell will consist of seven layers made up of earth, water, fire, air, ether. Earth will have fragrance, water will have taste, fire will have form, air will have touch, and ether will have sound. And then that sixth layer is ahankara. Ahankara will have the mind, intelligence, and 10 senses, 5 jnana, 5 karmendiyas. The outward layer is ahankara, amadi, mahatattva. Like that, there are seven layers. So with these seven layers, there appeared unlimited empty golden shells. So within that, eventually later on, from which the universal form composed of the mass of jivas, Hiranyagarbha, arose, as if waking up from sleep and coming to life. Of course, how this universal form comes is mentioned in the 53rd verse, but here as a matter of subject, it is also mentioned. At the 53rd verse, we will discuss about what is this Hiranyagarbha and how it arose, etc. So when all the elements were separate, the Lord combined them with his cohesive energy. So with that combination, there appeared unlimited brahmandas who have no life. Annam achetanam utitam. The lifeless brahmandas were created and all of them were floating on the Karana ocean. So that is indicated here.
Hare Krishna.
Amatish.
Shivaji, that means this lifelessness of those eggs is termed as unintelligent over here.
Yes.
Okay.
Etadandam visheshakyam karma vridde dashottarai krama vridde dashottarai tayodibhi parivrutam pradanena vrutairbahi yatra lokavitanoyam rupam bhagavato hare.
The universal egg, or the universe in the shape of an egg, is called the manifestation of material energy. Its layers of water, air, fire, sky, ego and mahatattva increase in thickness one after another. Each layer is 10 times bigger than the previous one, and the final outside layer is covered by Pradhana. Within this egg is the universal form of Lord Hari, of whose body the 14 planetary systems are parts.
So, the universal globe called Vishesha, Etadandam Visheshakyam, the unlimited Brahmandas are formed by the combination of different elements. That universal egg or Brahmanda is surrounded by layers of elements such as water. Toya Adibi Parivutam. Basically, there are seven layers made up of earth, from starting from inside. Earth layer, water layer, fire layer, air layer, ether layer, ahankara layer and mahatattva layer. He is 10 times thicker than the previous layer. The thickness of the layer of water is 1000 million yojanas, or 1 billion yojanas. One yojana is equal to 8 miles, 1 mile is equal to 1.609 kilometers. So it's like approximately 13 kilometers. So the earth layer thickness is 1 billion yojanas and water layer is 10 billion. Then fire layer is 100 billion. Then air layer is 1000 billion, something like that. If you start counting, each 10 times bigger than the previous layer, that is like that. And all these seven layered Brahmandas, seven layered Hiranyakashipus, they are all covered by a eighth layer known as Prakriti. It is Prakriti is like that material sky, the entire material sky can be called as Prakriti. So within that Prakriti, unlimited Brahmandas are situated. The example, we can see that in a bag of mustard seeds, so within the bag there are situated hundreds and thousands of mustard seeds. So one seed is equal to one universe. And the bag is equal to Pradhana. So within that bag of Pradhana, there are unlimited Brahmandas consisting of seven layers made up of earth, water, fire, ether, Ahankara and Mahatattva, something like that. So within the universe are the variety of planets which are a form of the Supreme Lord. So before understanding what is this, so let us see. When such unlimited Brahmandas are formed, which are covered by Pradhana, and all of them were floating in Karana Ocean. So they were floating on Karana Ocean for 1000 celestial years. So then what happened? After combining all the 24 elements, after the Brahmandas are manifested, then they were floating there lifelessly for 1000 celestial years. After 1000 celestial years, Karunadakshaya Vishnu expands himself as equal number of Garbhodakshaya Vishnus. And one Garbhodakshaya Vishnu enters into one universe. That is mentioned here. After 1000 years, 1000 Devata years, Karunadakshaya Vishnu expands and enters into the lifeless universe as Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, who will be known as Antaryami of each and every individual universe and gives it life. It is only Garbhodakshaya Vishnu enters into each and every Brahmanda, the Brahmanda becomes alive. Then that the Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, having entered into the universe, seeing that it is completely dark, he created water from his own body. That water filled the lower half of the universe. That is called Garbhodaka Ocean. And upper half is occupied by Mahatta, the air and ether. And then he entered into the water, began to taking rest. Then from his navel, there appears a beautiful lotus flower, which comes out of the water, goes to the top of the universe. That lotus flower is also made up of 24 material elements. And among the 24, there is also Mahatattva. Because of the presence of Mahatattva, that lotus flower was brightly shining. It is emitting so much brightness that the entire area which was dark previously becomes completely bright. And eventually that Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, in order to further the creation, already universe became alive and your lotus is born, and expanding himself as Kshirodakshaya Vishnu, enters into that lotus. Then there appears Lord Brahma on top of that lotus. And that Brahma later on divides that lotus into 14 planetary systems, and then he creates different living entities and things are started manifesting. But before all this happens, before the lotus manifested, the lotus is called as grass universal form. So just before that lotus became, lotus appeared, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu manifests the subtle universal form, consisting of all the living entities. That is called Hiranyagarbha. First, all the living entities appear from the navel of Garbhodakshaya Vishnu in a subtle form known as Hiranyagarbha. All the living entities in their subtle state without any grass body and subtle body. And then there comes the lotus flower from his navel. So that is called grass universal form. From that grass universal form, as Kshirodakshaya Vishnu enters into it, Brahma appears and Brahma divides the lotus into 14 planetary systems. And using the same 24 material elements, he creates different bodies for all the living entities who just appeared from Garbhodakshaya Vishnu's navel. And all of them gets bodies. They also gets a place to reside somewhere on the 14 planetary systems. And they start performing activities. Thus, Mahavishnu makes the dead universe into alive, filled with so many living entities and who are performing so many different variety of activities. So this is what the process of creation. वर्षपूगा सहस्रांते तदंडं मुदकेशयं कालकर्मा स्वभावोस्तो जीवो जीवं अजीवयत्। दिस इज फ्रॉम सेकंड कैंट फिफ्थ चैप्टर। आफ्टर ए थाउजेंड सेलेस्टियल इयर्स द लॉर्ड दैट इज महाविष्णु सिचुएटेड इन टाइम कर्म एंड स्वभाव ब्रॉट टू लाइफ द नॉन लिविंग यूनिवर्स विच वाज लाइंग इन द वाटर ऑफ कारण ओशन बै एंटरिंग इन टू इट एज गर्भोदक्षाय विष्णु। सो इट इज लाइक दैट। क्या हो गया?
हरे कृष्णा।
हाँ माता जी।
Regarding that, how subtle bodies are coming out from Garbhodaksha Vishnu?
Oh, not the subtle bodies. So after Garbhodaksha Vishnu entered into the universe, since it was darkness, he created water. The lower half is filled with water, upper half is empty space. And then Garbhodaksha Vishnu enters into that water, inside the water, and he began to take rest. Then when he wanted to create, he looks into his abdomen. Then from his navel, there appears all the jivas along with their karma and swabhava in a subtle state. That means only atmas are there. They do not have any gross body or subtle body. So all these atmas combined together, it is called as subtle universal form or Hiranyagarbha. Hiranyagarbha is nothing but sum total of all the jivas that are going to stay in one universe. And then there appears... And then there appears from his navel the lotus flower consisting of 24 elements. So that is called, that lotus flower is called grass universal form. And Garbhodaksha Vishnu expands himself as Kshirodaksha Vishnu, enters into that lotus as its Paramatma. And then that lotus gives birth to Brahma on top of it. And that Brahma divides that lotus into 14 planetary systems. And that Brahma uses 24 elements and creates bodies for all the living entities, such as plants, animals, humans, and superhumans consisting of devatas, asuras, etc. So this is the procedure.
Okay, thank you, Prabhuji, I understand.
Mm-hmm. Hare Krishna. That is how the universe becomes alive. Jivo ajivam ajivayat. So in that way, the dead universe becomes alive by the entry of Paramatma, Garbhodaksha Vishnu. So now, the next, it continues further. Hiranmayad andakoshad uttaya salileshayad tamavishya mahadevo bahuda nirbibedakam.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Virat Purusha, situated himself in that golden egg which was lying on the water, and he divided it into many departments.
Yeah, as we were talking that all the living entities, all the jivas appeared in the form of Hiranyagarbha, which is known as the subtle universal form. So the different bodily components have been manifested in the subtle universal form eventually later on. It's basically, every jiva will have all the elements in our body, the 24 elements, which manifest in the form of the senses, grass body and subtle body, etc. So many things are there. So how these individual body limbs are manifested first in the universal form, then eventually same thing is replicated in all the living entities. So how it happened in the universal form is being described in the current verses. So rising from the golden globe, lying on the water, the Supreme Lord situated himself there and differentiated the apertures of his body at the universal form. So it is basically the Garbhodaksha Vishnu, who is situated within the waters of Garbhodaka Ocean. From his navel there appears the subtle universal form known as Hiranyagarbha. In that subtle universal form, there appeared one after the other all bodily limbs, starting with mouth. So that will be discussed in the future verses. Nirabhidyatasya pratamam mukam vani tato bhavat vanya vahnir ato nase prano to grahana etayo प्राणे तो घ्राण एतयो
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल अ माउथ अपीयर्ड इन हिम एंड देन केम फोर्थ द ऑर्गन ऑफ स्पीच एंड विथ इट द गॉड ऑफ फायर द डेटी हु प्रिसाइड्स ओवर दैट ऑर्गन Then a pair of nostrils appeared, and in them appeared the olfactory sense as well as prana, the vital air.
So, first of all, this subtle universal form, the Hiranyagarbha, manifested its mouth. Nirabhidyatasya pratamam mukam. So, the mouth first manifested. And after the mouth has been manifested, there appear two more things, Vani and Vahani. Vani is the speech. This is subtle sense organ. And Vahani is the fire, the presiding deity over mouth. So both the subtle sense organ known as Vani or speech and the presiding deity known as Agni, both of them entered into the mouth of the universal form, because the universal form is their office, is their place of activity. So Agni is given the responsibility of looking after mouth activity, speech activity, speech organ of each and every living entity. So in that way, the first mouth appeared, then there appeared speech, the subtle sense organ, and also the presiding deity Agni. And both of them entered into the mouth, because the mouth is their office. That is where they have to perform their services. So in that way we can see. And then there appeared nase, the nostril, the gross nostril, the gross organ known as nostril. After that nostril, there appeared prana and ghrana. Prana is that breathing. The prana is nothing but that pancha pranas, we say 10 pranas or 5 pranas, whatever we have, prana, samana, udana, vana, prana, apana, samana, udana, vyana, like that. And grana means the subtle sense organ of smelling. Both of them appeared. Prano grana etayo. The next verse talks about their present deities. So along with their the prana and grana is the subtle sense organ of smelling, that their deities, Vayu and Ashwini Kumaras, will enter into the nostril of the universal form. That's how one after the other organs are manifested in the universal form. First is both make a bit differentiated. Then the organ of speech, the subtle sense organ, appeared. With the organ of speech, the fire devata appeared and entered the mouth. Both the speech and fire devata, both of them entered the mouth. The two nostrils became differentiated. And penetrated by prana, the sense organ called the nose, subtle nose, grana. Nasika is the grass, the physical nose. The grana is the subtle sense organ, which actually takes care of the transmission of this fragrance from the nostrils to our heart in that way. Corresponding to the two nostrils appeared. So in that way. If you remember in previously, initial part of the second canto and third canto, we discussed about, we have the sense organs, grass sense organs in our body, the two eyeballs, ears, nose, nostril, tongue, skin. These are the five jnanendriyas and then five karmendriyas, hands, legs, mouth, anus and genitals. The sensor, subtle sense organ are chakshu. Grass organ is akshni. Akshni means the eyeballs, the fleshy eyeballs. Chakshu means the subtle sense organ, subtle eye. Karna is the gross ears. Shrotram is the hearing process. Nasika is the nostril, the fleshy nostril. And grana is the sensory mechanism, the fragrant sensory mechanism. Talu is our palate. And jiva is tongue, the subtle tongue. And tvak is the subtle skin. And charma, here supposed to be charma should be there. Charma is the grass skin. And hasta is our physical hands. And subtle sense organ is able to work. Able to collect the things and give the things, charity or etc. And pada is the grass legs. Ability to walk is the subtle sense organ of the legs. And mouth is mukam. And here what is that? Actually here something wrong is there. So here is supposed to be speech. The subtle sense organ is speech. and the grass in Sarvangarg is mouth, and anus, gudam and payu, the excretory function, and shishna and upastha. So these are the deities for all the elements: Surya, Digdevata, Ashwini Kumara, Varuna, Vayu, Indra, Upendra, Agni, Mrityu, and Prajapat Daksha. These are the sense objects, these are the elements, and these are the activities of the Karmendriyas. With hands we do karma, with legs Sharanya and Kshema, with mouth speech, with anus act of evacuation, and genitals act of procreation, something like that. So one after the other, all the elements manifestation is mentioned. Granadvayur abhidyetam akshini chakshuretayo tasma suryo na vidyetam karno shrotram tato disha.
In the wake of the olfactory sense came the wind god, who presides over that sense. Thereafter, a pair of eyes appeared in the universal form, and in them the sense of sight. In the wake of this sense came the sun god, who presides over it. Next, there appeared in him a pair of ears, and in them the auditory sense, and in its wake the dig devatas, or the deities, who preside over the directions.
So as we saw in the previous verse, first there appeared mouth, then speech and Agni. So speech and Agni entered into the mouth of the universal form. And then and there appeared the two nostrils. Then afterward there is prana and there is grana. So the deity of prana is Vayu, the deity of grana is Ashwini. And Ashwini and Vayu along with prana and grana entered into the nostril of the universal form. And then there appeared the eyes, eyeballs, Akshini. The subtle sense organ Chakshu, the subtle eyes also appeared along with the deity Surya. The both Chakshu and Surya entered into Akshini and they took care of the function of the Akshini. And then there appeared the Karna, the two grass ears. Then the subtle sensory mechanism known as Shrotam, hearing process, subtle sense organ, along with the Digdevatas, the present deities. Both Digdevatas and Shrotrum entered into Karna of the universal form, in order to look after the function of the ears. So in that way, niribiddeda virajastva romas svarshvadayatata tatavoshayat oshadayas chasan shishnam niribibidetata.
Then the universal form of the Lord, the Virat Purusha, manifested his skin, and thereupon the hair, mustache and beard appeared. After this, all the herbs and drugs became manifested, and then his genitals also appeared.
So then there appeared the skin. Tvag means skin. Roma means the hairs. Smashu adaya, mustachu. The skin will have the bodily hairs and mustachu, etc. They all appeared. And the preceding deity of the hairs and mustache is the herbs. The preceding deity of the skin is Vayu. So they also appeared, and they along with the herbs entered into the skin of the universal form to look after the function of the skin. Then there appeared Shishnam, the genital, Nirbidyatta. So in the next verse talks about the deities, etc. Retastasmat apasan nirabidyeta vaigudam gudat apano panacha mrityur lokabayanaka.
After this, the faculty of protection and the god who presides over the waters appeared. Next appeared an anus, and then the organ of defecation, and thereupon the god of death, who is feared throughout the universe.
So the Shishna, either grass is a grass organ, then Retas is a subtle organ, then there appear the deity known as the ocean, Apa. So the ocean god and Retas, both of them entered into the Shishna of the universal form. And eventually there appeared the grass organ, Payu, Kudam. Then there appeared the function of the excretion and the present deity of that, prana apana vayu, and the deity is Mrityu. So prana, apana, Mrityu along with that payu entered into Gudam. So that is how it is mentioned. Astau cha nirabhidyetam balam tabayam palam tabhyam tatasvarat padau cha nirabhidyetam gatistabhyam tatohari.
Thereafter, the two hands of the universal form of the Lord became manifested, and with them the power of grasping and dropping things. And after that, Lord Indra appeared. Next, the legs became manifested, and with them the process of movement. And after that, Lord Vishnu appeared.
So then eventually, there appeared the two hands. The first, the grass and the physical fleshy hands appeared. So then balam, the subtle sense organ of the hands, that balam, by that strength with which we can collect some things from the hands, we can lift something, we can push something, we can throw something, all the functions of the hands. And then the deity of the hands, Swarat, here Swarat means Indra. Both Indra and the balam entered into the hands of universal form in order to look after the function of the hands. Then there appeared the legs, the fleshy grass legs of the universal form. And the function of the legs is to move, to go from one place to other place, known as Gati. And the present deity of this Gati is, this legs is Hari. Here Hari is a Devata, not Lord Vishnu, in whom the Lord enters with his powers, according to Jiva Goswami. So this Hari is not Lord Hari, but is one of the Devatas who is also known as Hari or Upendra. At some place it is mentioned as Upendra, here it is mentioned as Hari. But he is one of the Devatas only, is not the Supreme Lord. And he, along with that ability to go from one place to other place, Gati, both of them enters into the legs of the universal form to look after the functions of the legs of all the living entities. So, in that way.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji.
Prabhuji, the universal form is the imaginary form, no? Like earlier also.
Nothing is imaginary. Universal form does exist. It is imagined in the sense that as long as the universe exists, universal form exists. Or once universe is destroyed, the universal form becomes destroyed. So in that way,
because
it is considered to be imaginary.
When we are discussing that the fleshy hands and fleshy legs, so in the universal form, actually there are hands and legs. That way we should understand.
No, universal form is a functional form. It is like universal form. Hiranyagarbha is nothing but all of us, na? Hiranyagarbha is nothing but all the atmas. So universal form is having legs means all of us having legs.
Okay.
And universal forming eyes means having eyes means all of us having eyes. So all our eyes are the eyes of the universal form. So in that way we have to see.
Okay, so all the jivas bodies are whatever things are there, that fleshy things we are talking about when we are saying here.
In that way, there is no separate person such as universal form in that sense.
Okay, so in that way it is not existing, but in this way we have to understand it. In every individual jiva's body, whatever things are there that are belonging to the universal form itself.
It is a subtle, it is a functional form of the entire universe. So in that way.
Okay, thank you, Prabhu.
Correction. Nadyosya nirabhidyanta tabhyo lohitam abhrutam nadyastata sambhavam samabhavan udaram nirabhidyata.
The veins of the universal body became manifested, and thereafter the red corpuscles of blood. In their wake came the rivers, the deities presiding over the veins, and then appeared an abdomen.
So, then there appeared Nadi. Nadyo means Nadi. The veins of the universal form there appeared. Then afterwards, the sense organ which spreads blood and other substances. That tabhyo lohitam abhrum, then nadyas tata sambhavam. The devatas of the veins, known as the rivers, appeared. Then the stomach appeared. So like this, one after the other, all the things appear. Udaram nidrabidyata. Shut pipase tatasyatam samudrastu etayorabhut atasya hrudayam binnam hrudayan mana uttitam.
Next grew feelings of hunger and thirst, and in their wake came the manifestation of the oceans. Then a heart became manifest, and in the wake of the heart, the mind appeared.
So basically, the gross organ known as stomach. Within the stomach, actually gross organ known as nadis and stomach, both of them appeared. And the function of the nadis is to circulate blood, and the function of the stomach is kshut pipasa, hunger and thirst. They also appeared. And the preceding deities of the nadi are the rivers. And the preceding deities of the stomach are ocean. The ocean and the rivers, along with the hunger and thirst and the blood circulation faculty, all of them entered into the nadis and the abdomen of the universal form. So they will look after the functions of the abdomen of the Lord and the nadis of the Lord. So internal organs. So in that way, these functions will be taken care by them. So basically, oceans are directly related to kshut and trut, kshut pipasa, hunger and thirst. And the rivers are directly related to the nadis within us. So in that way. And then there appeared the heart, the gross heart appeared. So within the heart, there is a portion which is meant for mind. The mind also appeared. Heart appeared, then within the heart, a small portion which is dedicated for mind also appeared. Manasas chandra majato buddhir buddhir girampati ahankaras tato rudras chittam chaityas tato bhavat.
After the mind appeared, intelligence appeared next, and after intelligence, Lord Brahma appeared. Then the false ego appeared, and Lord Shiva. And after the appearance of Lord Shiva, came consciousness and the deity presiding over consciousness.
Yeah. First, the gross organ known as heart appeared. Within the heart, the subtle sense organ mind, and mind's deity moon. Then intelligence, buddhi, and intelligence preceding deity is Lord Brahma. Girampati. Giram is walk. The vacha or Saraswati. The husband of Mother Saraswati is Lord Brahma. And then there appeared subtle sense organ known as Ahankara. The preceding deity of Ahankara is Rudra. Then finally there appeared the subtle sense organ known as Chitta. The deity of Chitta is Chaitya or Lord Vasudeva. So like that, so the gross organ known as heart appeared, and within the heart there appeared mind, intelligence, ego and chetana, and their deities Chandrama, Girampati, Brahma and Rudra, Lord Shiva, and Chaitya, that is Paramatma, known as Lord Vishnu. The four of them appeared one after the other, and four of them entered into the heart of the universal form to look after the functions of man, buddhi, ahankara, chetana. So the man, buddhi, ahankara, chetana, all these four elements actually situate within our heart. Heart is the location of the four aspects of the antakaranas: mind, intelligence, ego and chitta. Karana means senses, anta means internal. So these four called as internal senses. The five jnanendriyas and five karmendriyas, they are called as bahya karanas. They are called as external senses which interact with the external world generally. So in that way, Chaitya refers to Lord Vasudeva, the deity presiding over Chitta. As Sankarsana, he is the Antaryami of Prakriti. So this Vasudeva expands himself as Sankarsana, who expands himself as Mahavishnu. He will be the Mahavishnu, the Antaryami of Prakriti, the Paramatma of Prakriti, the material nature. And then the expansion of Sankarsana is Pradyumna. Pradyumna expands as Garbhodaksha Vishnu, and Garbhodaksha Vishnu is the antaryami of the Hiranyagarbha. He is the antaryami of the entire universe, consisting of the mass of all jivas of the entire universe. So in that way. And then Pradyumna expands himself into as Aniruddha. Aniruddha expands as Kshirodaksha Vishnu. He is the antaryami of all the individual jivas. So this is how all the four deities and their relationship is being indicated. Vasudeva, Sankarsana, Pradyumna, Aniruddha. So Sankarsana is Karnadaksha Vishnu. Pradyumna is Garbhodaksha Vishnu. Aniruddha is Kshirodaksha Vishnu. And Karnadaksha Vishnu is the antaryami of Prakriti. Garbhodaksha Vishnu is the antaryami of one universe consisting of all the living entities known as Hiranyagarbha. Aniruddha is the antaryami of each and every individual living entity.
Prabhuji, by antaryami you mean Paramatma?
Yes, antaryami means Paramatma, super soul.
Okay.
It is by his presence those things becomes activated. By Karmadasha Vishnu's presence, by his entry into Prakriti as its Paramatma, the Prakriti becomes activated and gives rise to 24 elements. By the entry of Garbhodaksha Vishnu into a dead universe, the universe becomes alive and there appears the universal form. By the entry of Kshirodaksha Vishnu into that lotus, there appears Brahma and eventually all of us will get a body. Our body becomes functional. So in that way, as long as Paramatma is there in that body functions. If Paramatma is not there, the body does not function. So it is like that.
Okay.
Etehi abhyuttita deva naivasyottapanesakan punar avivishukhani tam uttapayitum kramat.
When the demigods and presiding deities of the various senses were thus manifested, they wanted to wake their origin of appearance. But upon failing to do so, they re-entered the body of Virata Purusha, one after another, in order to wake him.
So initially, when all the gross organs have been manifested, like the mouth, the eyes, the ears, the nostril, and hands, legs, the devatas are also created. They also entered into their respective organs, but the universal form did not become functional, did not get up and start doing activities. That means the living entities did not become active to perform activities. So it is said that the devatas who had appeared were not able to awaken the universal form. They again, one after the other, entered the respective bodily limbs to wake him up. So since the devatas could not wake up the universal form Virat Rupa, they again entered the apertures one after the other to wake him up. This is described to show that the Antaryami possesses all powers by their emerging from and entering into the Lord. So the rest of the chapter is all indicating that without the presence of Antaryami, even the rest all are there, the body does not function. The dead body will also have Chetana, mind, intelligence, ego, the gross sense organs, subtle sense organs, and the gross body, everything might be there. But that body does not function unless until there is Paramatma. So that is the rest of the chapter. Paramatma's main role is being indicated here. Vahinirvacha mukambeje nodatishtatato virat ghranena nasike vayur nodatishta tadavirat.
The god of fire entered his mouth with the organ of speech, but the Virat Purusha could not be aroused. Then the god of wind entered his nostrils with the sense of smell, but still the Virat Purusha refused to be awakened.
So the fire devata along with the speech organ entered the mouth, but universal form did not get up. The air devata along with the sensory mechanism, the fragrant sensory mechanism entered into the nostril, but the universal form did not get up. Akshni chakshu sadityo nodatishta tadavirat shrotrena karnau chadisho nodatishta tadavirat.
The sun god entered the eyes of the Virat Purusha with the sense of sight, but still the Virat Purusha did not get up. Similarly, the predominating deities of the directions entered through his ears with the sense of hearing, but still he did not get up.
Yeah, even sun and seeing entered the eyes did not happen much. The direction deities and the hearing mechanism entered into the ears. Virat Rupa did not get up. Twacham Roma Bir Oshadayo Nodatishta Tadavirat Retatha Shishnamapastu Nodatishta Tadavirat.
The predominating deities of the skin, herbs and seasoning plants entered the skin of the Virat Purusha with the hair of the body, but the cosmic being refused to get up even then. The god predominating over water entered his organ of generation with the faculty of procreation, but the Virat Purusha still would not rise.
Same thing. The plants and herbs along with the hair sense organ entered the skin. Virat Rupa did not get up. So the ocean god along with the organ for sex entered into the penis, but Virat Rupa did not wake up. Gudam mrityur apanena nodatishta tadavirat astav indro balenaiva nodatishta tadavirat.
The god of death entered his anus with the organ of defecation, but the Virat Purusha could not be spurred to activity. The god Indra entered the hands with their power of grasping and dropping things, but the Virat Purusha would not get up even then.
Murtu Devata along with the evacuation organ entered into the anus, and Indra along with the strength entered into the hands, but universal form did not get up. Vishnur gatyaiva charanau nodatishta tadavirat nadir nadyo nadir nadyo lohitena nodatishta tadavirat.
Lord Vishnu entered his feet with the faculty of locomotion, but the Virat Purusha refused to stand up even then. The rivers entered his blood vessels with the blood and the power of circulation, but still the cosmic being could not be made to stir.
The Devata Vishnu entered the moving ability into the legs, and the river Devata along with the circulation organ entered into the veins, but Virat Rupa did not get up. Shutrubhyam udaram shishindur nodatishta tadavirat hrudayam manasa chandro nodatishta tadavirat.
The ocean entered his abdomen with hunger and thirst, but the cosmic being refused to rise even then. The moon god entered his heart with the mind, but the cosmic being would not be aroused.
The ocean god, along with hunger and thirst, entered into the stomach. Nothing happened. And Chandra, along with the mind, entered the heart of the universal form, but universal form did not get up. Buddhya Brahma Pi Hrudayam Nodatishta Tadavirat Rudro Abhimatya Hrudayam Nodatishta Tadavirat.
Brahma also entered his heart with intelligence, but even then the cosmic being could not be prevailed upon to get up. Lord Rudra also entered his heart with the ego, but even then the cosmic being did not stir.
So Buddhi along with Brahma entered into the heart. Rudra along with Ahankara entered into the heart. Still universal form did not get up.
Chittena hrudayam chaitya kshetrajna pravishadyada virat tadaiva purusham salila dudatishtata.
However, when the inner controller, the deity presiding over consciousness, entered the heart with reason, at that very moment, the cosmic being aroused from the causal waters.
So when Vasudeva, the Antaryami, along with the Chitta, entered the heart of the universal form, then the universal form suddenly rose up from the waters of Garbhodaka ocean and began to perform activities. So the understanding is, till now all the different devatas and the different bodily limbs are trying to wake up the universal form by their presence, but the universal form did not become functional, did not become alive. It is only when the antaryami, the kshetrajna, so the paramatma entered into the universal form, then the universal form became alive and began to perform activities. But when Vasudeva entered the heart along with Chitta, the Virat Rupa rose up from water. Here Chaitanya is Vasudeva, the antaryami kshetrajna, for as the Gita says, kshetrajna chapi mam vidhi sarva kshetreshu Bharata, know that I am the knower of the field situated in all bodies. So in that way, it is only when Paramatma enters into the universal form becomes functional. So another way, if you see, even when the lotus came out of the navel of Garbhodaksha Vishnu, the lotus was there, lotus flower was there along with the stem and leaf. It was not doing anything, nothing much happening. But it is only when Garbhodaksha Vishnu expanding a Kshirodaksha Vishnu and he entered into the lotus flower, then only there appeared Brahma on the top. And Brahma began to perform activities, something like that. This Virat Rupa becomes functional, becomes active only when there is Paramatma. Without Paramatma, though we may be having everything else, but that body with all the other bodily limbs is simply a useless thing. It is only when Paramatma is there, the body becomes useful and functional.
Prabhuji, here who is referred to as Paramatma? I mean, Garbhodaksha, Kshirodaksha, some other itself. Like, I'm getting a bit confused.
So here the Paramatma is Kshirodaksha Vishnu.
Kshirodaksha Vishnu. Okay.
Kshirodaksha Vishnu. It is when the Garbhodaksha Vishnu, will be there always in the waters only. So the subtle universal form manifested, it is when Kshirodaksha Vishnu manifesting from Garbhodaksha Vishnu enters into that lotus or enters into that Hiranyagarbha. That Hiranyagarbha, the lotus becomes functional or becomes alive.
Okay, so that Kshirodaksha Vishnu is again Paramatma in every living and non-living being.
Every living entity. Either Paramatma in every living entity in that way. So here in this verse, for us to understand, one example is shown. So let us see that example, if it makes sense. Yata prasuptam purusham prane praneendriyamanodiya prabhavanti vinayena nota payitum ojasa.
When a man is sleeping, all his material assets, namely the vital energy, the senses for recording knowledge, the sense for working, the mind and the intelligence cannot arouse him. He can be aroused only when the super soul helps him.
Similarly, just like the universal form did not get up, in spite of all the devatas who are trying very hard to wake him up by going into their respective bodily organs and trying to wake him up. So he was not getting up unless Paramatma entered. Similarly, the pranas, This example is with respect to our individual body. The prana, the five pranas, the 10 senses, 5 jnanas, 5 karmendriyas, mind and intelligence, by their own strength, cannot awaken a sleeping individual. Prasuptam purusham. Prasuptam means deep sleep. When a person is in deep sleep, neither the pranas, nor the senses, nor the mind or intelligence does not get up, does not wake that person from the deep sleep. Only the Paramatma can do that. Without the intervention of the Supreme Lord, it cannot happen. The Chaitya or the Chitta. So the understanding is, I will give you one example from Bhagavad Gita Shloka. With that, I will explain. Indriyani paranyahur indriyebhya param manaha manasastu para buddhir yo buddhe parasastu su. So can anyone tell me the translation of this verse? All of us have studied this.
Vijay, I will try. Actually, I don't know, but indriya means above the indriyas is the other mind. Above the mind is the intelligence, and above intelligence is soul, and above soul is the super soul.
Okay, here it is only talking about soul only. The senses, indriyani. Paranyaho, the senses are considered to be superior to the dull matter. Our body is made up of dull matter, earth, water, fire, air, ether. So, in comparison to this grass body, the 10 senses are superior. But the mind is superior to the senses, as it is even stronger and active during dreams when the senses do not function. So mind is said to be superior to the senses. So normal understanding is, during the daytime, when we are awake, we as a person are awake and our body is able to perform some activities. Our senses are in active state, they will be able to grasp the information, Jnanendriyas and the Karmendriyas are able to function in any way. So daytime, our full personality is active. And in the night time when we sleep, it is Jagruti, Swapna and Susushupti. Daytime means Jagruti and the night time Swapna. We are sleeping. When we sleep, our grass body becomes dysfunctional. Grass body does not do any functions. And our 10 senses also become dysfunctional. In the sleep, our senses become inactive. They don't perform. Our legs does not move. Our hands does not carry weight or something. Our mouth does not speak. Our eyes does not see. Our ears does not hear. Something like that. The 10 senses becomes sleepy. They become inactive. But in that sleepy state, we will have so many dreams. We can have so many dreams. So all the dreams are created in the mind. So in the dreamy state, we ourselves identify ourselves as a person in the dream. So we may go to sleep tonight and in the dream we may get a dream that we have become a bird and flying over mountain, the Mount Sahyadri, or we may have become a king and riding a chariot or doing horse riding, something like that. We can become anything. So in the dream, what is happening? Though we are a person sleeping in a particular place, we forget our identity, what we are. But we identify ourselves with the person in the dream. If the person in the dream is a king, so we think ourselves as a king. And we ride on the chariot or ride on the horse, something like that, and fight in the battle, something like that. So what is happening? In the dream, our grass body is changing. Because grass body is changed, we have acquired a different grass body which is created by mind. We identify ourselves with that personality. So in the dream, we may be a bird, we may be a devata, we may be a king, or we may be an elephant, we may be a tiger, something like that. So we identify ourselves like that. So that time, the mind is still active. And we are also identifying with the body which is created in the mind, the dream body. So our ahankara is also active. And we are aware that we are performing so many activities. Our chitta will is also active. But the 10 senses, the 5 grass elements are inactive. The body which is made up of 5 grass elements is inactive. And the 10 senses are inactive. The supervisor of the 5 senses, known as intelligence, is also inactive. The supervisor of the 5 karmendriyas, which is known as prana, is also inactive. 5 grass elements, 5 jnanendriyas and the intelligence, 5 karmendriyas and prana, all these are inactive. But in a dreamy state, our mind, our ego and our chitta, all these 3 are active. Then, one step ahead. But compared to the mind, buddhi, vijnana or chitta is still stronger. Wow! During deep sleep, even the mind does not function, but the chitta remains active. If a person goes into deep sleep, one does not even get the dreams. So if we really have a sound sleep, as soon as we go to bed at 10 o'clock in the night, we get sleep. And the next, it appears that next moment only we got up at morning at 4:30 or 5 a.m. So we don't feel that we slept for 6 hours duration. That is the state of deep sleep. In the deep sleep, we forget everything about ourselves. We forget that I am so-and-so, Pavaneshwar Das, as a Brahmachari in Chowpatty temple. All this identity, all this understanding, everything is gone away. That means, and we don't get any dreams. That means the mind also becomes dysfunctional. And intelligent, and the ego also becomes dysfunctional. The only thing that is still active is our chetana. That chetana is called buddhi here. So, superior to this buddhi is atma. But compared to chitta, the famous jivatma is superior. So here, the chitta's deity is Vasudeva. The Ahankara's DT was Rudra, and mind's DT was Chandra, and intelligence DT was Brahma, and the DTs are the 10 senses were various DTs are there. So though all of them were there in deep sleep, all the elements are there in our body, all their DTs are also there in relation to our body, but we cannot get up. It is only by the intervention of Chitta, or by the intervention of the DT of Chitta, that is Vasudeva, we get up. If you remember last week, we gave an example. I gave an example that if I am sleeping in our Hava Mahal, which is located just above our base classrooms, and in the evening at 4:30, just about to become 4:30, that time we get to hear our Lakshmana temple shank. They blow the shank and they give the darshan to all the devotees after the during the aarti, etc. So first, when the shanka blows up, I will hear, my chetana becomes aware of some sound. Then my intelligence becomes active, having collected the information through the ears, and it analyzes what sound is that. The intelligence will tell that it is the sound of the shanka, conchal. Then the mind, my mind will develop a desire or hatred. If it is the sound of the conchal, the mind will say it is the conchal sound of our Lakshmana temple. They continue to hear. If it is the horn sound of a vehicle which is going in front of our temple, the mind will say, don't hear this sound. You want to sleep further, close your ears. The two hands will close the ears, something like that. And then the Ahankara becomes active. It says that, okay, now it is 4:30, get up and take bath and go for darshan. Then the person gets up and starts performing activities. If it is the horn sound of a vehicle, the Ahankara will say, hey, you have already tired so much, you sleep for some more time and you will be relieved. You will be relieved of all the tiredness. Something like that Ahankara will teach. Ahankara will tell, and the body goes into further sleep. So this is how our body functions. This is how our body limbs actually becomes activated one after the other. So it is basically, it is the chitta or the chetana or the mahatattva, which is the element which is close to Atma. Anyway, Atma is always alive. The next element which is alive even deep sleep is chetana or chitta. So chitta is directly connected to Paramatma. It is only when Paramatma instigates, a person gets up from deep sleep. Otherwise, in the deep sleep, there could be a big, huge sound also around us. The person does not get disturbed and does not get up from the sleep. So this, all of you also might have experienced this. When somebody is in deep sleep, something big thing is happening around, but still we may not be aware of it. So it is only when we get up, so when people start telling us, okay, so and so happened, then we will inquire about it more and more. So in that way. So in order to illustrate the condition of the universal form, an example of the individual body is given. Just as the mind and intelligence cannot awaken a person sleeping with in deep sleep without the Supreme Lord, the present deities of Chitta, the Supreme Lord, the present deity of Chitta, the other devatas cannot awaken the universal form without him. So in that way. This example is clear?
Even in coma, deep sleep and coma
is, it is very psychologically unconscious state, na? Though internally the mind is functioning, is coma, it's actually the physical body becomes completely disabled in that sense. The internally organs are functioning, the mind, intelligence might be functioning. Coma is actually a different state, not like deep sleep.
Okay, Prabhuji.
In coma, they say that subtle body is active, but the gross body is completely inactive. That's why person is not able to interact with people in that way.
Okay.
So this is the last verse of this chapter. Tamasmin pratyagatmanam dhiya yoga pravruttaya bhakta viraktya jnanena vichintatmani chintayet.
Therefore, through devotion, development and advancement in spiritual knowledge acquired through concentrated devotional service, one should contemplate that super soul as present in this very body, although simultaneously apart from it.
So, The explanation about the nature and characteristics of all the 24 elements along with Pradhana, Kala, Jiva and Ishvara, the whole purpose is to help us understand that out of 24 elements, the most important element is Chitta. Out of all the Devatas, the most important Devata or the personality is Paramatma. So instead of wasting time in order to look after the welfare and comfort and enjoyment of all the other elements, just work for the welfare, comfort and requirements of Chitta and Paramatma. In order to help us understand the importance of the worship of Paramatma and the importance of taking care of our Chitta, the analysis of all these elements has been discussed in this chapter. One should ascertain ascertain the nature of all the elements and then contemplate the Supreme Lord. He who can be internally perceived as Paramatman within the body, which is a combination of cause and effects in the Jivatman. By unmotivated bhakti, how one should be able to meditate upon this Paramatman? By unmotivated bhakti, that is viraktya bhaktya. And by jnana, by the process of jnana, using the intelligence motivated by bhakti. Either meditate upon, contemplate upon, worship the Paramatma directly by bhakti, or contemplate upon by the practice of jnana mixed with bhakti. So by these two processes, one should come to a conclusion that instead of looking after the welfare of other elements, one should look after the welfare of Chitta or the deity of Chitta. The goal of explaining the analysis of all the 24 elements in this chapter is to help us understand the importance of contemplating on the Supreme Lord with Ahetuki Bhakti, because he can be perceived as Paramatma or Pratyagatma, who is situated internal inside the body, which is the combination of cause and effect, or in the Jivatma. So the Paramatma is situated within the body or within the Jivatma, and he is the cause of all causes, and he should be meditated upon either by the practice of Ananya Bhakti or by the practice of Bhakti Mishra Jnana. So this is the whole reason with which the entire chapter has been presented, in order to help us understand the nature and characteristics and the limitations of the respective elements and their respective deities. So this is one of the important subject of Jnana Yoga, known as Sankhya Yoga. It is also called as Swadhyaya. The different sadhanas of Jnana Yoga are Swadhyaya and Tapasya. There are many more, but the important one is Swadhyaya and Tapasya. Swadhyaya includes the study of the nature of 24 elements and other elements, and trying to come to a conclusion that among all the 24 elements, Chitta is most important, and the purpose of life is to understand the deity of Chitta and worship him and contemplate upon him. So that is the whole idea. Hare Krishna. Any questions till now?
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji.
Prabhuji, in this chapter, we talked about 24 elements. Then at some places, there is a mention of 25 elements where we add the Jiva also. And then there is a mention of 26 elements. And then last, there is mention of 28 elements where all the Jiva, Prakriti, Kala and Supersoul all are added in, apart from the 24 elements. So, means I was confused that when we are supposed to talk about 24 element, when about 26 and when about 28, like whether in any particular context we are supposed to discuss like that?
Or? Nothing like that. So, our body or our visible universe consists of 24 elements, and they are all produced from Pradhana, and Pradhana becomes activated by Kala. And all this is done by Ishvara for Jiva's enjoyment. So this is the interrelation between all the 28 elements. Ishvara impregnates Pradhana with Jiva Shakti and Kala Shakti. by the interaction of jivashakti and kalashakti pradhana gives rise to 24 elements by the combination of these 24 elements there appear the entire universe and the 14 planetary systems all our individual bodies so that we can perform various activities to fulfill our independent desires so this is how we have to see them together
okay so we talk about means when the 28 elements means I understood you explained it very nicely but when we will talk about means only when about the body has to be discussed then 24 elements or at the material plane only when we are discussing that time only 24 elements will be taken into consideration and when yes. universe we are talking about that time 28 elements will be, right?
yes
okay.
Even our individual body also we have 28 elements na we have the yes. grass body made up of the 5 grass elements and their properties subtle body made up of the 14 elements and we ourselves atma is there and ishvara is there and as paramatma and we are governed by the 3 modes of material nature that is pradhana and we perform all the activities under the influence of kala even yeah. with respect to also 28 are there
yeah
okay. Ishvara is paramatma jiva is atma and prakriti is our three gunas the 3 modes of material nature and kala is kala the time frame in which we are existing
okay thank you
correction anyone else any queries okay if there are no queries we'll have a small break about a couple of minutes and then we'll continue maybe 5 minutes we'll take a small break